our reading from the Gospel according to Mark. On the first day of unleavened bread, with the Passover lamb as sacrifice, his disciples said to him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the owner of the house, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples? He will show you a large room upstairs, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there.'" So the disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he came with the 12. And when they had taken their places and were eating, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They began to be distressed and to say to him, one after another, "Surely not I." He said to them, "It is one of the 12, one who is dipping bread into the bowl with me. For the Son of Man goes as it is written of him. But woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
It was not the first time that the Passover meal had been shared in Jerusalem. It was not the first time that Jesus had done this particular meal with his disciples. If you look at the calendar, in the Jewish calendar, this event happened in the year 3793. For generations, going back to the time of Moses, people had gathered and shared a particular meal. Everything about it was symbolic. Everything about it was a reminder, not just of a religious ritual, not just as a historic custom, but as something that defined who they were in the very presence of God. All along this Lenten season, we've been talking about decisions. We've been talking about the choices that are being made. On this particular day, Jesus and his disciples had a series of choices to be made. The first was whether they would eat the Passover. Every day we make choices of whether to follow God or not. Every day, whether conscious or unconscious. On this particular day, the disciples knew there was no place they would rather be and nothing they would rather be doing than to be in the presence of their teacher, in the presence of the one who had been identified as being the Messiah. And so, can you imagine saying to Jesus, "Where do you want us to be?" They didn't say, "Hey, we found this great restaurant, and we got some coupons that were in the paper, and the buffet is really top notch." No. They said, "Where do you want us to be? Where will you be happy? Where will you honor your God and our God? And where can we be so that we're with you?" Do you get how significant a question, that is, they weren't just asking a logistical inquiry. They were asking, where can we be with you? Now, what happens next is one of those moments that when you're reading the Bible, you have to kind of wonder at Mark. You know, he gives us information, and then he gives us maybe more than we're looking for. Do we really need to know that they're going to follow a guy carrying a jar of water? It's just a guy with a jug of water. What's so special about that? Well, I'll tell you. That jar of water wasn't for drinking. It wasn't to wash feet. It wasn't for cooking. It was for the ritual of cleansing. That when we go into the presence of God, we go bare, stripped away of all pretense, of all that stuff that has been weighing us down day after day. And we come into God's presence, and something has to happen to us. In the ancient world, they understood that mortals did not come into the presence of the divine and live. But the Jewish understanding was, not only was it possible, it was required. But God doesn't suffer fools easily. And those things that are so precious to us out there count for nothing before the throne. And so before we come into the presence of God, we have to be ritually cleansed. That's why in some Christian tradition, this idea of confession is so central to what they're doing. Now, we, United Methodists, we don't do it as often as perhaps we should, but we still do it in various ways. We'll do it a little bit later when we offer the Lord's Prayer. That's a confession. So, Jesus gives them what they need so that they can be in the presence of God. He gives them the resources they need. He tells them where. He tells them why. He tells them how. He tells them when. And with who. There's not much left for them to decide, except will they obey a seemingly inconsequential, routine decision. Now, what happens next is fun. They find this guy. It's a crowded city. It's Passover time. The place is packed. And they find the one guy carrying a jug of water. That's pretty cool. I mean, come on. If that's not a miracle, we need to redefine it. But they find this guy. They follow him. Now, you're Bob, you're walking down the street with a jug of water, and there's a couple guys following you. Now, you can either say, why are you following me? Or you can run, drop your jar of water, throw it at them. There's all kinds of choices. But the guy goes where he's supposed to be going. And the owner of the house, Mark doesn't record the exchange, but since we know how it turned out, we can assume that the decision was upstairs. So far, so good. We have disciples making decisions. We have Jesus making decisions. We have a guy with a water jug making a decision. We have a house owner making a decision. So far, all the decisions have pointed us to this moment. All those seemingly innocent decisions, all those acts that we make every day, have at their core the moment that Jesus is here to announce. Now, the Feast of Unleavened Bread is also known as Passover. This is the defining moment in the Jewish calendar. Was then, is now. Everything in their religion is centered on this moment. They're not doing it out of custom or out of habit. They're doing it because they understand that in this act of deliverance, God defined who they were. Jesus is doing that same thing for his disciples. Everything that they are, everything that they have been preparing up to this moment, has been leading to this act of eating together. It's just another meal, but it's just another meal. It's just another Passover. It's just Jesus. So what's so special about it? Well, think for a moment. Hazel, you cook, right? Some people do, apparently. How much work do you put into your cooking? A fair amount. Okay. If you are going to cook a meal, you have everything in your house that you need today for a meal.
A meal, yes. A holiday meal, probably not.
Okay. What else? Oh, well, Hazel says she puts a lot of effort into her cooking. Candy says she has stuff for a meal, but not the meal. All right. So, how do we match up the effort with the preparation? Hello.
Hello.
You make decisions. Candy, what would you need to buy to make Lynn Mosher's favorite meal?
Well, first I'd have to know what that is.
You would?
Yeah. I'd have to do some planning and some research.
Okay. So you have to do some planning and some research. Well, first you have to figure out what plant, what they eat on that plant. But, oh, plan, not plan in. Oh, I'm sorry.
Do
you
think Lynn was on the plant?
Well, so there's some planning that has to be involved. There's some decisions that have to be made. What is going to be made? Who is going to be made for? Would you make, Benita, you're a pretty good cook. I've had your cooking before. If Cammy gave you, you plan the meal, Cammy does the shopping, and Hazel does the cooking. Now, so far, so good. We know the how, the when, the where, and the why. Now, what would happen if We went to all this trouble of making the meal of all time, but didn't invite Lynn to the meal.
Sounds good.
More for Bill. Whether to participate in the preparation of this meal for this person. But unless we invite that person for whom it was prepared, it's just wasted effort. So as we go through the rest of this day, that you're remembering all the little decisions that bring you to that moment of awareness. Remember why you're doing it. What the point of all this life is about. If we do all the hard work but don't include God in what we're doing, it's just wasted motion. If all we are about is looking after our slice or our corner of the picture but don't include the artist, or don't include the patron for whom this work was given, it's just wasted effort. So as you go through this day, as you look forward to the coming week, think about how you are going to include God in it, and how you are going to include each other in the preparation, in the sharing of not just a moment, but the life and the life giver. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in this prayer of invitation. Dear Lord, we thank you for those servants of yours who have chosen to pattern their lives after you, to shepherd a flock of your people in the role of bishop. Give us generous hearts that